back in 19, I think it was 1998 or 96, when medical marijuana was first voted for and approved here, dispensaries, collectives rather, were starting a collective, a group of people who decided to get together, let's say this group of here, people over here, and some of those people then knew how to grow, had maybe a place to grow, and had, you know, had things that they could do to help that help that crop grow. Whereas somebody in that group was unable to grow. They were either in a wheelchair, a lot of Vietnam vets, smoking marijuana for pain, and all sorts of post-traumatic stress syndromes. So they weren't able to grow. So the idea is that we would form a collective. Those people who could grow did. Those people who didn't grow would support them, that when the crop was harvested, they would go in and donate to the fund to be able to use the marijuana that was grown. That enabled the people who grew it to use those expenses to pay for the lights, utilities, help them have some money themselves, but they were working almost full time to do this. That was called a collective. But they were quasi-legal. It wasn't quite legal. Proposition 215 said you could grow, possess, and use marijuana in California. But the question then became, what are the people who couldn't grow, didn't have a space to grow? And that's why the collectives began to form, when people got together to help themselves. Well, the collectives were private, and they restricted who could come in or not, because up until the time of dispensaries here in California, or wherever you happen to run into marijuana, it was always hushed. It was always underground. It was always secretive and laced with crime, because it was illegal. And the people who sold it, drug dealers, they also sold cocaine, perhaps, maybe LSD, maybe had some roofies, maybe had some other things that you could pick up. But that doesn't mean that people who went and got marijuana wanted to do those other things. But all that was lumped together as simply drugs, bad news. So our society, the community, parents, the people who were not smoking, and people who would get drug tested always had bad things to say about marijuana, because of the nature of how it was capitalized. So today, because it's considered medically okay and recreationally okay to smoke, then people can do it wherever they want to. But that's not really true. Because when I looked at the law, it said you can smoke marijuana in California. However, you can't smoke it at the beach. You can't smoke it in the parks. In fact, you can't smoke outdoors. You live in a condo, you can't smoke in a condo or an apartment. So the question becomes, well, where can you smoke? Well, if you have a home, smoke in your backyard, smoke inside. But every place else, the landlord or somebody in charge of the building where you live can say, no, you cannot smoke that here. So the question is, then what do you do? Well, you're part of the underground, which is where most people today really are. Even though recreationally, you can smoke. But it's still not like it was. Because I have a relative right now in Texas, which is the worst state in the world, to even have anything to do with marijuana. You don't want the smell on you, you don't want to have any seeds, nothing, because it's all illegal. And one of my nephews who traveled around to all the marijuana states enjoying discovering marijuana went home, back to Texas, and still had one of those vape pens in his pocket. He got picked up, and now being charged with felony. He said, well, I've been in 13 states, having a good time, almost outdoors, parks, you know, in clubs, in lounges, smoking, and experiencing this marijuana world until he got back to Texas, and that was a whole. So we still have a long way to go. The fact that this room is not filled with people must mean that they are all knowledgeable about medical marijuana, it's recreationally, you know, they know about that. But that isn't the case. In most cases, is that we still haven't gotten to the point that we feel free to come out in a public setting like this and discuss it. So the library here is a perfect setting for this kind of a situation. What I'm here to do is simply to give you an idea of what happened to me guy. However, when I went up with my foot, I went to my treatment after my first operation. The doctors would say, "Oh, Mr. White, you know, this is strange what's happening to you. You know, your PSA numbers," and for men that means prostate-specific adjuvant, is what the prostate excretes. And that's measured to determine what number is in there. And you can determine whether or not that secretion is cancerous. It usually isn't, but in the case of black men, a lot more than other races, that secretion is usually cancerous. So at some point in time, most black men are going to encounter what to do about prostate cancer, or at least a swollen prostate. For me, I found a practitioner who said, "I think you should try this." And I tried that religiously. You know, I smoked every day. I was out of the Navy. I had no reason why I could not. I was being drug tested. So doctors would say, "Well, what's the point? Your numbers are going down." And that just shouldn't happen. You are an anomaly. And I said, "Well, you know, I smoked marijuana." He said, "Well, Mr. Martin, we can't discuss that here because that was a military hospital." Said, "Well, whatever you're doing, you just keep doing it." And so I kept doing it. Now, I'm not telling you that that's what got me here today, but the doctor was saying, "We don't understand what's going on." Well, I told him what's going on. Well, fortunately for me, or for my daughter, she works in MD Anderson in Houston, Texas, which is one of the premier hospitals, especially for cancer. She worked in a cancer ward, and actually is in urology, and work around doctors who do this all the time. She is the physician's assistant. And she said, "Dad, the doctor said it was right. Those numbers should not be going down like that because you're not doing anything that they have given you to make that happen." Well, one good thing about marijuana is that it doesn't come with a long list of side effects. And if you watch television and you hear them say, "Hey, you have a rash on your back, that's something that's bothering you with your elbows, take this new medication and it'll make you feel better. But oh, aware that your liver could go bad, your eyes could do this, your skin's gonna do that, you gotta take these tests and make sure you're not doing that. But these are all the bad things that could happen to you if you take this medication." And like I said, for marijuana, you may laugh a little bit more than you usually do. You may eat and snack a little more than you usually do. Maybe if you take indica and you couch out and you can't get up and go to the bathroom and sit there and just eat, that's fine. That's all it's gonna be. You don't get violent. You don't attack the ladies in the street. You don't bust into liquor stores and, you know, go crazy. There's no fights. People sitting in the back room with nice lights going on and some mellow music, and they burn candles and smoke. A very mellow situation. So that's what usually happens. So what I mentioned is that when society today looks at still whether marijuana should be or how they should look at marijuana, we still have the fact that the people who grew it were the ones who named it. And you have to know if you're growing it, you're probably smoking it. So it was named by stone growers. You know, they were ripped. And they called it AK-47, as Girl Scout cookies. There's something called green crack. Something called fucking incredible. And it is. Bubblegum, ice, kush, Dr. Dragon, Tropic Truffle, something called Larry Bird, Snoop Dogg, Forbidden Fruit, Watermelon, Z Kitty Fire, Rocket Ball, Woo Diddy Gucci, Sour Strawberry, Durban Poison, Gorilla Glue, Space Gorilla, you can go on Pineapple Express, Dr. Grape, and Snowman. That's just one of 1,376 different strains of only sativa. I didn't even mention the indica. So those are all crazy names. So then how does the medical society say, "Oh, let's accept this and take this on, and so Mr. Wyatt or Mrs. Smith or whoever it is, we're going to recommend that you smoke green crack. This doesn't go over well." So it's kind of tough for the doctors to communicate with patients. And this is going to be a problem in the future. So what some dispensaries do is that they lump the effects of marijuana together. Means we'll take, if you want to relax, then we call this relaxation. And it may be 6, 7, 8, or 10 different strains that you can go to the dispensary. And under the sign relaxation, pick any one that you like. Or if you wanted to be creative. These are the creative strains. Well, these are the strains that will help you with sleep. These are the strains that will help your libido, your libido. Take a tick up. And so they call them arousal, calm, creative. And then you go to the dispensary and you say, well, what's that that's helping me be creative? He said, look over here. Well, they no longer come in a big jar where the bartender takes off the lid and takes a spatula out and gives you, doles out your things and measure. Today, the law requires that every single dispensary have a vendor who already grows their own product, already cleans and processes it, puts it in some sort of a container, which has to tell you that Proposition 215 and House Bill 420, what that means, that it's dangerous, not to be used by children, 18 and over, all that sort of thing, and what it contains. So now you're paying for a glass jar, all that wrapping, all that writing, and everything else. Inside of all this packaging is 1/8 of marijuana. 1/8 of marijuana is about the size of 3/4 laid side to side. Not much at all. But the expense of the glass, of the plastic top, of the paper, and everything that comes in, has boosted the price up tremendously. Top shelf marijuana, when I first went to the dispensary, probably sells at about $320. Today it's $510, plus taxes. Taxes run about 19% because the state taxes the grower, the vendor, the tax the dispensary owner, the tax the user. It's going to get its money. So the states are having a great time with this new resource of money. In fact, one dispensary called Harborside in Oakland, California, used to call himself Oaksterdam, just like Amsterdam back in Denmark, or Holland, wherever the heck it is. In that, it was one of the largest dispensaries there was, with over 7,000 members. A serious, serious problem that dispensaries have, and this is that it's a cash business. Banks, because they're federalized, will not allow dispensaries to put money in the banks. So dispensary owners have a problem. What do you do with all the cash? The first dispensary I worked with was right in my neighborhood in Hillcrest at the time. They were open 6 months, and the reason they got busted, the bank reported them because they put in the bank over $700,000 in 6 months' time. And I was there leaving, and when I was leaving, the police girls were rushing me in. I said, something's not going to go right over here. Something's wrong. That night they were on the news and it was carrying the guys out because dispensaries were not legal. None of them were. However, in Los Angeles, there were over 400 of them. You could go up on a street corner in front of a dispensary and put money in a vending machine and get whatever smoke that you want. Just show you a medical marijuana card. So this was crazy, crazy times. The law now has it so that that's been regulated. They closed up most of those extraneous dispensaries, and now the ones that are in here are few and far between. In fact, all this last week I've been around passing out flyers and visiting dispensaries in the area. Now I'll come off a list called Leafly, leafly.com. On there it will show you all the strains of marijuana there are and all legal dispensaries here in San Diego and what those dispensaries sell. Well, there used to be, on the back of the reader, I remember, maybe 20 pages of those dispensaries. So the last time I checked, they were down to 3, because all those extra dispensaries that were legal have closed and moved on. And now only the legal ones are there, and they're huge. Well, the huge dispensaries have a huge problem, but they probably are collecting more than the $700,000 that the guys who are doing illegally have. In fact, the dispensary, I mentioned the Ocean Avenue dispensary, they paid over $2,500,000 in taxes. That's just taxes on what they collected. The guy wouldn't even say what that really came out to be. But he did say we've got vaults hidden. They bury it places. They take it and have to do the crazy things. So one of the big things that have to happen regarding this marijuana is the federal system coming in so that people can legally bank that money, because it's going to become a more serious problem. Now, when we went around last week with the list that we had, half of the people who were on the list were now closed. They were supposed to be legal, but they weren't. And what happens is that have to hold a legal dispensary, you're going to have to come up with a check of over $100,000. It's a cashier's check. This means I got cash money in the bank. Plus I got to pay a registration fee. That's over $9,000. And up in the Vista, which was about 2 months ago, I think, they had a list out saying, we want to open up, we have 11 outlets. I don't know how many people showed up, but they all had to have, before we even considered it, a cashier's check for $100,000. $9,000 for their application, which is not refundable. That's just to apply. Well, people did it because if they were accepted and you open up the dispensary, hey, the sky's the limit as far as the kind of money that's going to come in there. Today, as opposed to when the dispensaries were first opened, they would have to be non-profit. Today, they're profit. It means the people are going to make money. And so the vendors, people who grow, people who package, people who deliver, people who are bud tenders, people who own it, and people who check it as far as making sure that it's clean as it has to be, are all in the process of making a lot of money with this thing. So my goal is to be able to talk to people like yourselves, to be able to have you go out and realize that we can open up conversations and discuss this, knowing more about what's truthful and not what is just rumored to be what's going on. So when I mentioned about with this lecture being what is cannabis and why do people use it, as I said, the reason why people use it because you can self-medicate and not have all the bad side effects that are going on with over-the-counter and doctor-prescribed medications. That's what people tell me happens. Once again, I'm not here to let you know anything other than that. And I had, as I said, is cannabis smoke just to get you high, or is it there for medical purposes? And I said, the answer is yes, it is there to get you high, and it is there for medical purposes. There's nothing wrong with that, because for some reason, the FDA thinks that for a drug to be good for you, it has to come with a lot of terrible things you have to consider, things that require you to take more medication. When my brother came out here from New York, he showed up with a shoebox full of medications. And it was astounding. I said, you take all this? Well, really, not all this, but I just love my medicine. And he only lived 3 more weeks before he passed with a severe heart attack. I had 2 for hypertension and a big bag of smoke. That's what I smoked. He didn't smoke that in New York because he couldn't get to it. You know, there you have nickel bags, those seeds and stems I told you about. That's still what goes on in New York. And very, very expensive. We can take smoke from here at 310 and go to New York and sell it for $7.50 because they don't grow it here like there like they do here. So I think I covered about everything. Are there any questions anybody might have?
Will you be passing on in other classes how to, since the dispensers are so expensive, will you be passing on information on how people can cultivate and grow their own product and have the same types of things that the dispensary has?
Thank you very much for that question. The answer is yes. The last class is going to be how to grow marijuana, growing marijuana indoors and out. What does it take? What does it cost? And that'll be the last one. And there are over 200 seats assigned for that purpose. I think that'll be a bigger class than this, obviously. But yes, I will be doing it.